introduction of the newest ARB, that is Azacitan. Do you think that with these newest ARB Azacitan, because of certain definite advantages, will it replace the current ARBs?
Definitely, Azacitan has made an impact in the management of hypertension. It is one of the promising newer agents. In fact, as compared to other sartans which are there currently, like telmisartan or olmesartan, it has shown a significantly increased BP reduction in management of hypertension. In fact, olmesartan came in as a double digit BP lowering agent. Azacitan, I would say, would go beyond that. And we are also awaiting combinations. So with combination therapy, it would be a potent force to reckon with as far as hypertension management is concerned.
Right, sir. So, sir, with the availability of the recent 2017 ACC guideline, which says that now the new target for the blood pressure reduction is 130 by 80. So, do you think that the Azacitan will have a place to achieve that BP target?
Yes, definitely. Because traditionally, if you look at the data from on-target trial, sartans are very poor BP lowering agents. In fact, in on-target trial, the actual BP lowering, mean BP lowering was something around 7 to 8 millimeters of mercury. But when we are looking at Azacitan, we are looking at least 15 to 20 millimeters of mercury, and that's significant. If we want to go down from 140 by 90 to 130 by 80, we need more efficacious molecules, and that is where role of Azacitan like molecules come into the picture.
Right, sir. Sir, in relation to the patients with heart failure, there are various comorbidities which can definitely affect the morbidity and mortality of the patient. So, in such patients, do you think that the INDP is the most neglected comorbidity?
In fact, one of the most unmet need in the management of heart failure and one of the most ill addressed concept is iron deficiency. In fact, we as a cardiologist need to be more aware about iron deficiency in heart failure, and definitely iron polymaltose, carboxymaltose injections, which are very safe, very much devoid of any side effects, are indeed a boon to these patients who have iron deficiency in heart failure, and they work wonders.
Alright, sir. So, sir, in such patients of heart failure, do you want to give any message to the budding cardiologist or the practitioners that most of the patients of heart failure will definitely will have some amount of iron deficiency, and we need to address this iron deficiency and investigate with the iron?
In fact, we need to investigate more with serum iron and ferritin levels and transferrin saturations in such patients, which we do not do as of today, but we need to look at it from the chronic heart failure perspective, and whenever they are there, we have to correct it, and that would definitely reduce the amount of drugs we use for management of chronic heart failure.
Right, sir. And the last question, sir, so many therapies are available for the management of iron deficiency, oral iron, iron sucrose, ferric carboxymaltose, isomaltose. According to you, so which will be the best fit for managing iron deficiency in heart failure?
Definitely a complete infusion of IV infusion of iron is very much useful. Earlier it used to be very much problematic because of issues with anaphylaxis and other things, but those issues are definitely not there with this particular compound, and it is indeed very safe to use even as a outpatient basis.
Right, sir. So thank you so much, sir, for such an informative talk.
Thank you so much.
Welcome.